Do expensive receivers sound better than cheap receivers? That's the question I want to answer for you today in this video. But before I do that, please make sure you're subscribed to our channel. Hit the bell notification down below, that way you get notifications when we release videos like this. Hey folks, I'm Gene Della Sala with Audioholics. All right, let's get down to it. Everybody wants to know, if you spend more money and get an expensive receiver, are you gonna get better sound quality than a cheap receiver? So I'm not gonna make you watch this whole video to give you the answer. I'm gonna give you the answer up front and then I'm going to basically tell you why. Yes, generally speaking, expensive AV receivers sound better than the really cheap ones. Here's why. Several reasons why, actually. You have to really realize something about AV receivers as opposed to other products in the AV market or in the consumer market, is most AV receivers are very low margin products. They cram a lot of technology into a product at certain price points that they have to meet, and they make mass quantities of these products. That way they could get economies of scale going into these products and get them to you at a cheaper price to hit certain price points, whether it's $250, $500, $1,000, $2,000. So when you're looking at receivers today, let's say a $500 receiver, it's a much different product today than it was two decades ago. You know, two decades or three decades ago, a multi-channel receiver typically consisted of five-channel amplifier and a DAC and some processing like Dolby Digital, for example. So you had a pretty decent amount of performance crammed into for $500. Don't forget inflation today compared to back then. So your value of your dollar was worth more then. So when you look at a $500 receiver today, yes, you have the latest in HDMI switching, which you didn't have two or three decades ago. So you didn't have that expense of the HDMI boards and the DSPs and all that stuff associated. You didn't have as many licensing fees 20, 30 years ago as you do now. So you can have Atmos today and you can have, you know, all these different kinds of room correction. So all this stuff adds cost to the product that's still trying to hit that $500 price point. So what happens? What do these manufacturers have to give up in order to hit those price points for you? The first thing they're gonna do is they're gonna shrink that power supply. You guarantee it, you're not getting a big transformer in a $500 receiver. And now they're also, instead of putting five channels of amplification into that chassis, that same size chassis now is gonna have seven or maybe even nine channels of amplification. So now you have to dissipate all of that heat onto the same size heatsink areas. And you just can't do that unless you either go Class D, which most budget receivers are not, because it costs a lot of money to do Class D right, or you have to put a lot of nannies into the product. You have to bias them at a lower quiescent current so they're not dissipating as much power out of the transistors in steady state, and that can sometimes lower fidelity. You have to put a lot of protection circuits in there. So I would say, and I'm gonna basically say this definitively, I wouldn't recommend any $500 receiver on the market to drive a real 4-ohm speaker, because most of them just fall apart. And don't get caught up into those stupid impedance switches, because that makes things worse. If you set that impedance switch to the low setting, you're robbing your speakers of power. They're just trying to meet UL certification, so they derate that amplifier in the 4-ohm setting so it doesn't dissipate as much power. So that way when UL goes and tests it in 4 ohms, hey, it's running cooler, it passed the test. We have a couple of videos on that. I'm not gonna dive into that topic too much further. But just think about what's going on at a $500 receiver today compared to two decades ago. So you have very low ability to drive sustained high output levels with 4-ohm speakers with inexpensive receivers. Most receivers today, that's the case. You just can't get the kind of 4-ohm drive that you used to get. You really got to spend a lot of more money, or you got to use the preamp outputs to an external amplification. So if you're gonna compare, let's say, a $500 receiver today to a $2,500 or $3,000 receiver, even in the same series of the same brand, let's say Marantz, for example. So you go with the lowest line Marantz. I don't even think they have a receiver at $500. I think it's like $800. the SR5014 or something like that. There's a significant difference in sound quality from that receiver to the SR8012. The SR8012 has a much bigger power supply. It's got a big toroid in it, bigger power supply capacitance, so there's less ripple voltage. It doesn't sag as much when it's trying to drive a lot of current off of the line. The transformer doesn't saturate. You tend to, with smaller power supplies, if you try to draw too much power from them, it saturates and it adds distortion. And you can see this if you do an FFT. You're not going to do a quick instantaneous distortion measurement at 1 kHz and say, hey, yeah, this receiver's clean. That's why I go so extensively into the measurements, and I look at FFT plots and I look at DC offsets. I look to see how the thing is biased at below 20 hertz to see how that DC level goes up and down, whether it's driving a load at low power or high power. All this stuff matters. So you kind of have to really break it down to understand it. So in the example of the Marantz, the SR8012, that receiver is really a good receiver. I would say it's on par with some of the higher end receivers from a few decades ago in terms of its juiciness and its amplification. I mean, they have really good heat sinks in that thing, 2 rows of heat sinks as opposed to just 1 row. So it's, you know, it's dissipating a lot of power, but it's doing it across 2 rows of heat sinks for 11 channels of amplification. And they use better quality transistors in those receivers than the cheaper receivers, so they handle 4-ohm loads better. And you could see this when I do my bench test on a good $2,000 or $3,000 receiver versus a $500 or even a $1,000 receiver. The $1,000 and below receivers just fall apart on 4 ohms. There's so many nannies in the thing. If you try to drive 4 ohms with more than 1 or 2 channels driven, the current limiting steps in and you're going from 150 or 200 watts down to 50 or 60 watts. So in those cases, if you're driving speakers full range at 4 ohms, there's quite a significant difference between inexpensive receivers and more expensive receivers with bigger amplification and bigger power supplies. Now, I'm not just going to focus on the amplification, because that is the biggest problem with budget receivers. The other thing is DACs, the D to A converters, what takes the digital signal and converts it to analog. Now, DACs have gotten a lot better over the last decade or so. You don't have to spend a lot of money. You could buy an external DAC to plug into your headphones today for a couple $100 that just sounds amazing compared to that technology didn't exist 20 years ago. But if you really want the best quality in an AV receiver, you tend to get better chipsets in the higher priced receivers. You get better DACs, better noise rejection, better layout, better parts. And again, this is stuff I see when I measure signal to noise ratio or I measure different distortion criteria. So all of this stuff is measurable. Whether it's audible or not really depends on many factors. It depends on what kind of speakers you're using, how good your room acoustics are, how your listening habits are, because you could listen at very low level and not hear a difference. But if you like to hit reference levels, you're not going to hit reference levels with 4-ohm speakers in a big room with a $500 receiver. And then I know someone down below is going to say, well, what about if I use the preamp outputs on a cheap receiver? Won't I get the same or better sound than an expensive receiver with the internal amplifiers? My answer to that, it really depends, yes or no. Because I've been looking at the preamp outputs on a lot of the AV receivers today, and many of them will actually clip the power amplifier, the internal power amplifier in the receiver, if you drive them past about a volt, 1.2 volts. And that's a problem, because even though you're not using those amplifiers, just leaving those amplifiers open circuit and cranking that volume control up, and if you start clipping those amplifiers, that distortion actually feeds back into the preamp circuits and it could mess up the FFT on those. So you could see distortion spikes. And I saw some of this even on the Marantz SR8012. When I was driving it past 1.2 volts, I started seeing the third order harmonics go up. I'm not going to say that that's definitely audible, but it's something to note that a lot of the cheaper receivers, for example, you can't get a $500 receiver with multi-channel preamp outputs. You got to spend about $1,000. But most of the $1,000 receivers that I've checked the preamp outputs on, they have, you know, they don't do a good 2 volts RMS clean. And the reason why I like to see 2 volts RMS is most amplifiers, if they have an AV gain or voltage gain of 29 dB, you need about 2 volts RMS to get full power out of that amplifier. So you don't want your preamplifier clipping before your power amp clips. So again, it all depends on the measurements. It's why you really have to look when we do receiver reviews, look at the preamp sections, how I measure them, and look at the power amp sections, look at the FFT distortion and all that stuff. So I think that answers the question, at least in my mind. Yes, more money does buy you better performance in AV receivers. Number one, you get a better power supply, better output devices, the ability to drive 4-ohm loads that you can't do with the cheaper receivers. You get better D to A converters, better DSP, less noise, higher resolution, and you usually get better preamp output sections. So if you want to run external amplification to power up, the better receivers, the more expensive receivers, give you that flexibility. Some of them even have a preamp mode. The Denon X8500H has a preamp mode that'll turn off all of the internal amplifiers and disconnect that circuit path. So you could turn that receiver up. You could get almost 4 volts RMS out of the preamp outputs and you're not gonna clip anything. So that's one of the exceptions to the rule. The Denon 8500 is a beast. It almost pays homage to their receivers from two decades ago, the 5800 series. Those were some of the most amazing receivers. And I will tell you that today we're not getting that level of build quality, that level of refinement that we got two decades ago. Because back then we had $5,000 to $6,000 receivers. They threw everything but the kitchen sink at these things, and they still only had seven, maybe with the exception of the Denon, a 10-channel amplifier built in. They didn't try to put 13 channels of amplification into a smaller chassis. It was just a different time. It was a more civilized time for a different era. But you know, the super receiver of yesterday does not sell today, because now you can get separates. So if you're gonna spend more than $2,000 or $3,000 on a receiver, usually you wanna go the separates route. So I hope that answers your question. I'm curious to know what you guys think. Have you ever listened to cheap versus expensive receivers? Have you ever done controlled listening tests? And did you actually hear a difference in your setup? I'd like to know that. Please comment down below. Don't forget to subscribe. And don't forget about our Patreon channel at patreon.com/audioholics. We give you lots of benefits. We give you content there first. We're starting to do some technical slide presentations on PowerPoint that we're going to be uploading that you have to be a patron to see. So it's definitely worth checking out a membership. And until next time, my friends, keep listening.